Oof, what a week. Hello, if you missed it, I am creating a first-person virtual tabletop, like a Roll20 meets Skyrim. The meta for this devlog was simple, create a proof of concept of this idea. And just so we're on the same page, it would basically need a map creator, a runtime 3D model importer, two different character controllers, and a save system. So, let's get to work. At this point, everything will be done in a quick and dirty way. I just wanted to develop the basic parts of the application to see if this was an idea that had legs to walk on. I started by creating a quick menu. I did this because I know that the application would be divided in its online and offline sections. So, might as well create the foundation for that early. Ending up with this.
Wow!
Yeah, not exactly the most glamorous menu. But it's something, and it's functional. Now, on to the fun part. I now have this empty scene. To quickly explain, a scene is for Unity like a blank canvas is for a painting. It is what you use to create a section of your game or your application. The first thing I wanted to do here was create a base surface for the players to walk around. The most basic form to do that would be a 3D plane with customizable size through your user interface. I made it so that when you enter this scene, you are presented with a prompt to input the desired width and height. These values would then, through a script, update the size of the 3D plane. And there we have it, the most basic 3D map creator ever. Now, I wanted to be able to explore this scene, so I needed to add a flying, moving camera. I wanted to emulate the functionalities of the Unity editor camera, basically using the WASD keys to move around and the mouse to look around. Because I have always felt that it was a very intuitive way to control the camera as well as feeling quite gamey. I could try coding this functionality from scratch, but something I learned from another project of mine is that the community is your best friend. So, I booted up Google and searched for exactly what I said before. Runtime, Unity, editor, camera control. And thankfully, I found exactly what I was looking for in the asset store. Probably the biggest tip I can give you if you're trying to create a quick prototype of your idea, use assets already created and available online. The important thing to keep in mind if you do something like this is to of course familiarize yourself with the asset you're importing, so you can better implement and connect it to the other functionalities of your game. As an example, in this case, the camera functionality wasn't exactly like I wanted. It was missing the clicking on the right mouse button to move, and it also made the mouse cursor disappear at all times. So, I went into the code and added those functionalities to reflect how I wanted it to work. Time to move on to the next objective, importing 3D models in runtime. As a first version, I wanted to implement a UI list that the player would use to spawn their objects. The functionality would be the following. This list would be automatically filled with buttons that were prefabs, each button connected to a 3D model inside a folder that, when clicked, would spawn that model. For testing this phase, I went to the website Thingiverse and downloaded the type of object I would use, a simple model of a medieval house. The biggest hurdle here was creating that list through a script automatically, because I wanted to check for .obj files inside the folder and then create a button for each model found. This was hard because I had to take into account the height of each button when spawning it in the UI, because if I didn't, it would look like this. That's 4 buttons stacked on top of each other. But I solved it by simply checking the height of each button in pixels and multiplying it by the number of buttons. With that done, I simply created a script inside each button that would save the 3D model assigned to it, and then a method that would spawn that model. Super easy, am I right? Well, here is where I found my first major problem. As it is, Unity can only create an object from a file path when in editor mode, meaning that when the game is played independently, it won't be able to import 3D models this way. And I will take this opportunity to explain something that will become increasingly more relevant. You have probably already heard me say the words editor and runtime. The editor is what you see here. It is basically the Unity software with all its functionalities that give you the tools to develop your game. Unity in itself already has most of the components I'm trying to create. So, why am I working on recreating some of these features? Leading us to runtime. When you want to distribute your game, you make what is called a build. In this build, Unity will truncate everything into an executable that you can play without the need of connecting to Unity itself, meaning you lose the access to all of the functionalities available in the Unity editor. So, when I say runtime, I mean when you're playing the game in this build and not in the editor. That's why that was problematic, but one that would be solved on another day. For my goal, this would do. And indeed, it worked. I was another step closer to finishing my proof of concept. Of course, the 3D model was imported with no regards for its scale or position, but that could be easily fixed by scripting the initial transform property values. But simply doing this won't do. I needed a way to move and interact with this object on 3D software that is usually done through the use of this, a transform handle that represents the three axes X, Y and Z. It can represent the position, rotation and scale of the object, and I wanted something exactly like this. So, what did I do? Use assets already created and available online. I thought for sure someone had already wanted to do something similar, and I found this insane package that did exactly that. I simply had to import it into our project. The handle worked well out of the package, but once again, I had to go into its code because it was missing a couple of things. The most important being the ability to select objects by clicking on them. And to explain it quickly, the script would check for clicks on the left mouse button. This would then create a line that went from the camera to the point in the screen I was clicking, and if this line hit anything, it would make it a target of the handle and make it appear. After that, I simply had to code ways to reset the selection and change the handle type. Completing this task was very exciting, because it marked the conclusion of the bare necessities for a game master to be able to create his map. Think about it, the GM now had access to a god mode to fly around, a base customizable surface on which to build the map, and finally a way to import and interact with the 3D files that could be NPCs or environment. With that done, I could move to the other pillar of this application, the player. Basically, a player needs to be able to move around using the W, A, S and D keys, look around using the mouse, and jump, meaning the most basic first-person controller. So, I created a capsule and the necessary scripts for these functionalities based on a YouTube tutorial I found. And you probably know this already, YouTube is a great learning platform. There are a ton of tutorials out there for Unity. And for stuff like this that are so essential to the workings of a game, you're bound to find tons of resources to help you achieve your objectives. To conclude this, I added a way to switch the view of the GM, meaning switching between the fly camera and the player camera. And I could now create the scenario and then explore it in first person. Check it out, the very first map exploration of the application. Very exciting times. So far, everything was going as planned, and work was moving at a very quick pace. At this point, we were only missing one thing, a way for the GM to save their map. I had never made a save system, but it probably wouldn't be hard. In my mind, I knew that for the save to work, I simply needed to save two things, the 3D models used and their transform information. With this, I could then, on the loading stage, spawn the 3D models and change their position, scale and rotation based on the information on the save file. To achieve this, I created what I called a saveable object to store the information I needed. Once again, with the help of YouTube, I then discovered a quick way to create a save file. And then, when loading, the save script would read from that file and create the object according to information that was stored in that saveable object. And well, it was done. I was very happy with what I was able to achieve. At this point, it doesn't look beautiful or very impressive, but theoretically speaking, with the online implementation of what is here, you could create a map with terrain and monster models and play a D&D encounter in it. And with this, I completed my first devlog with a very positive outlook of this idea. I was actually surprised at how quickly I was able to find solutions to the problems I created. And for that, the internet really is a great resource when trying to implement a quick prototype of an idea. And it can really accelerate the process by the use of assets or scripts that other people have already created. Looking forward, I'm already itching to try and implement online into this. So, for the next devlog, I'm thinking I will try and implement a basic online solution to see how it would work. Because honestly, I have no idea how hard of a task that will be. I believe this leads us to the end of the first devlog, and I want to take a second to thank everyone that already subscribed based entirely on the premise of my first video. I hope you enjoyed watching the video, and if you did, please consider subscribing and leaving a like in this video to follow along on the creation of this project. Thanks for watching, and see you next time for another devlog of the Metas project.